Otherwise, let me introduce Shawn Iserhoff. He's the Councillor of the Council of the Cree Nation of Mistissini. Hilda Snowball, she's a Nunavik Inuit. She's the mayoress of Norton Village of Kangiqsualujjuaq. Kirstin Scansen, she's from Saskatchewan. She's a Nehithaw Cree. She has an MA in Indigenous Governance from University of Victoria. Lorraine Rekmans, she's from Ontario, Serpent River Nation, Elliot Lake. She's the former director of the National Aboriginal Forestry Association. And we also have with us Ghislain Picard, the chief of the Assembly of First Nation of Quebec and Labrador. So we'll hear first Shawn Iserhoff.
Roger. It's loud. Hello, bonjour. I think Hugo mentioned, I think it was the first day, the symbolism of the goose to the Cree, it's a very sacred animal. In about 2 weeks' time, many of our Cree community members throughout the Cree Nation will be out on the land for a traditional hunt. Our schools close, organizations close, and it's a way of passing down traditional knowledge from our elders, our parents, down to the children. Thank you all for being here today. I am grateful to be part of this panel speaking on behalf of my community. And I'd like to welcome my fellow colleagues on this panel, Hilda, Kirstin, Lorraine, and Ghislain Picard. Merci à vous.
Thank you for being here, all of you, and sharing with us your knowledge and your determination to fight against the issue of uranium being developed on our lands.
I also want to begin by expressing my appreciation to all First Nations representatives and to the experts from around the world who took their time out of their busy schedule to attend this important world symposium on uranium in Quebec City. My name is Shawn Iserhoff. I'm councillor for the Cree Nation of Mistissini, and I was involved in the battle against uranium in collaboration with members of our community during my time as youth chief for the Mistissini Youth Council. I'm here today representing the Council of the Cree Nation of Mistissini, the members of my community, and also behalf of our chief, Richard Shakapio, who unfortunately could not be here with us today. I'm sure some of you are aware that a few weeks ago, a tragic incident affected our community with five young men perished in a fire, five hunters while out on the land. I want to start off by saying that as a member of the Council of the Cree Nation of Mistissini, I want to ensure everyone that our most important tasks are to preserve our traditional way of life, the integrity of our land, and the well-being of our community members. Several years ago, our community was eager to understand the possible benefits and the potential impacts of uranium exploration and exploitation when a company called Stratico began to show interest to carry out uranium exploration activities on our traditional territory, EUSG, which means the people's land. Throughout that time, our community members became more aware on the potential hazards of uranium mining on our traditional territory, and our members came together and still today continue to stand together in the fight against uranium mining. A big part of this movement is due to direction provided by our people and the efforts of both the Council of the Cree Nation of Mistissini and the Mistissini Youth Council. Together, we worked hard to raise awareness of the important issue by taking into consideration the opinions of those who live in EUSG. We were all concerned and had our doubts as to whether uranium mining can be done without jeopardizing the future of ancestral Cree traditional lands. Our community position was always very clear. There can be no uranium mining projects on our traditional territory without our prior consent. Our rights as Indigenous people were high priority, but it was also clear that we were not the only ones in the province of Quebec to take a rather dim view of the real benefits of uranium mining. For many people, any interest you might have had in the promises of economic development opportunities quickly faded away as we listened to the developers and heard the overly optimistic tone of their presentations in light of the serious issues it would create for our people in the long term. Given the seriousness of the decision to be made, it was unfortunate that our people did not have access to all the relevant information needed on the potential long-term impacts it posed on our traditional ways of life, our land, and on the wildlife. Without necessarily influencing our decision, perhaps it would have allowed for more informed and balanced dialogue with the proponent. Furthermore, we knew that any mining exploration or exploitation, whether for uranium or other minerals, has a downside and could even involve collateral damage to the environment and nearby communities. But the real impacts of uranium mining on the land and its inhabitants will only be manifested in the future, and we need to consider its repercussions for future generations. It's no surprise that there is a great deal of skepticism in our community. The mining companies play down the risk factors in their presentations and talk about controlling the risks as if these projects were like any other. But we know very well that they are not. And the careless management of waste could be devastating for generations to come. With the widely diverging opinions on the topic, we feel that the research is not yet sufficiently conclusive to say that uranium mining can be conducted with no danger to the current or future generations. We have a responsibility to make decisions in the interests of future generations. The underlying question in uranium mining is waste management. The figures are enough to make you shudder. Some say it would take tens of thousands of years before the waste is inert and no longer poses a threat to the health or the environment. It's therefore impossible to say beyond the shadow of a doubt that we can contain all the potential hazards arising directly out of uranium mining. As many have said, the studies are incomplete, and any claims to the contrary would only make us more mistrustful of the uranium industry. Since we define ourselves to a large degree by our attachment to our ancestral traditional lands, it is unthinkable to disassociate who we are from what we do on the land. The territory belongs to us, and we also belong to it. It is our Mother Earth. Our own preservation depends on the continued existence of our territory. A simple economic promise could undo the inextricable tie that binds us to EUSG. It is a risk we are not willing to take. How can we be sure that mining waste will be properly managed for tens of thousands of years? The Cree Nation will come to stand together and do whatever it takes to stop uranium development on its traditional lands. We have said it on many occasions, there will be no more uranium mining on our traditional lands. We have lived on our traditional lands since time immemorial. As stewards and protectors of the largest freshwater lake in Quebec, Lake Mistissini, we are strongly opposed to any uranium development. It goes against our way of life and our beliefs. We have clearly demonstrated that there can be no social acceptance on any projects. Il n'y a aucun projet d'uranium sur nos terres.
No uranium projects now and in the future.
In closing, I am grateful to have spoken on behalf of my community to be part of this symposium, and I would like to thank all our allies, Aboriginal people, and non-Aboriginal people who have taken action against uranium mining and invite others to do the same. This symposium is another example of these actions and also a great way to help people understand the importance of not letting our land be taken from us for extremely damaging projects. Short-term solutions are rarely the best, and uranium mining seems like the perfect instant solution that would create a devastating scenario for generations to come. So far, more than 300 Quebec municipalities have adopted resolutions against uranium development, including the Grand Council of the Crees and the Assembly of First Nations of Quebec and Labrador. In this fight for a Quebec sans uranium, we are not alone, and today we see that many around the world now stand together in the fight against uranium mining. I applaud their initiatives and welcome the alliance that brings us together, First Nations, scientists, and the various organizations opposed to uranium development. I'll leave you with this. Yesterday we saw a legend being shown at the World Uranium Film Festival. In our community, the Otish Mountains, where the proposed Matoush project is located, is sacred to us. Our elders speak of a giant within these mountains, and they refer to this project as that giant, and they say, have told us not to awaken the giant. Thank you.
Right now to invite Hilda Snowball.
Hey, if ever I say hey, you say ah. So I use this. Okay. First of all, I want to do something very unusual for you guys. Is everyone familiar with a selfie? Thank you. I am honored to be here, to have been invited to speak at the World Uranium Symposium on behalf of Makivik Corporation and for the Inuit of Nunavik. My name is Hilda Snowball, and I am the mayor of northern village of Kangiqsualujjuaq, and the community population is close to 1,000. To begin, I would like to read you the remarks made by the fellow Inuit resident during the public hearing held in Kangiqsualujjuaq on November 25, 2014 by the BAP, the Quebec Environmental Commission. The word that we use for uranium in Inuktitut is nunguyuittu, which means something that will never perish. It will be there forever, and it is a very strong word and warning, and it always catches everyone's attention when we use the word nunguyuittu. Nunavik is the northernmost region of Quebec. It is all the territory located north of 55th parallel. It is inhabited largely by Inuit, and we live in 14 mostly coastal villages. There are no roads or railways between Nunavik villages, and no roads or railways connecting our region to the rest of Quebec. We live in a remote communities, accessible by sea in summer and by air year-round. So my community is the easternmost of the region. For generations and generations, Nunavik Inuit have relied on the resources of the land and sea for survival. In fact, Inuit still today derive a considerable portion of their diet from the harvesting of marine and land wildlife. While harvesting methods and patterns may be changed over the years, the importance of harvesting for food production and identity has not. Wildlife subsistence harvesting activities such as hunting and fishing are essential to our continued food security and to the Inuit way of life, our culture and our language. Country food is not only a preferred diet, but also has been proven more nutritious than store-bought food. So if I ask you a question, what pops up to your mind first? What do you, when we talk about healthy food, what pops up to your mind first? Nunavik Inuit consume a wide variety of country food that is considered, for us, country food is considered healthy food, such as caribou, ptarmigans, Canada geese, snow geese, and other waterfowls, arctic char, whitefish, salmon, seal, beluga, and walruses. Blueberries, cloudberries, and other small fruits are also part of our traditional diet. So these are our healthy food. Our environment, our environment is already changing. However, public health studies show that most of Eastern Arctic communities are affected by contaminants being ingested from our traditional food sources. High levels of PCBs, which is polychlorinated biphenyl, however you pronounce it, and mercury have been detected. These contaminants do not come from our immediate surroundings. They are originating from greater distance and accumulating in our food chain. So if we have contaminants already, what can uranium do? Mining has been a concern for many years within Nunavik. Wildlife and Inuit harvesting are affected by mining activities. Inuit living in communities close to mine sites are especially concerned. Since we already know the southern industrial activities and mining can have and are having impact on northern environment, imagine how serious the concerns being felt now by the uranium industry. In the last decade, the uranium industry has taken a special interest in northern Quebec. In 2005, uranium resource potential was identified in the Dieter Lake area, which is south of Kuja. In 2006 and 2007, the rise of uranium price led to massive claiming in Nunavik, particularly in Kangiqsualujjuaq area and close to the Gurukjuaq National Park, which is near my community. In 2007 and 2008, claiming continued around Kangiqsualujjuaq and in particular close to our lands, Category 1 lands. In 2009, opponent to uranium development around Tsetseal requested a moratorium on this activity. And in 2013 and 2014, the BAB and Kadivik Environmental Advisory Committee conducted extensive public hearings in the uranium industry in Quebec and in Nunavik. So these two are the potential uranium sites. Pre-consultation and environment information exchange phases of the consultation process were organized in Kujuaq and Kangiqsualujjuaq by the BAB and the KEAC. As well, on November 25, 2014, the McKivik Corporation and Kadivik Regional Government, two major organizations in Nunavik, presented a summary brief in Montreal. Throughout the public consultation process, individual communities and regional organizations clearly stated their concern regarding the impact of uranium exploration and mining activities on the environment, wildlife, subsistence harvesting practices, food security, human health, and community well-being. Governmental survey and industry fieldwork reports show that the area around Kangiqsualujjuaq holds low uranium concentration potential, yet these areas are lands important to wildlife harvesting. Based on the cultural state of knowledge concerning the effects and risk associated with uranium exploration, exploitation, and waste management, particularly given the fact that Nunavik Inuit continue to rely on country food, Nunavik Inuit are opposed to any such activity in our region. Among the other consultation contained in the McKivick and KRG brief, I would like to mention the following. Because Inuit rely on wildlife for food, an effect on wildlife can also have a direct effect on human health. The risks from the entire uranium production chain are not well known, understood, and communicated. The state of knowledge is limited and many contradictions exist. So it was mentioned before during the workshop that there is not enough information to Aboriginals or Indigenous peoples on uranium. Okay. Next point, the state of the debilitating effects of fear created by perceived danger of development of an active Nunavik uranium industry must be taken into account. Inuit continue to depend on wildlife for a significant portion of our food. Much of the wildlife we harvest is migratory, which are caribou, fish, migratory birds, and any local contaminations will therefore affect the food source of our community, of other communities. We cannot tell the animals, for example, the caribous, the birds, that this area is contaminated, so don't go there. So Inuit continue to depend on wildlife, so we have to be very careful of what we're trying to do. Despite our opposition to uranium development in its current state, I want to point out that McKivick Corporation and Nunavik Inuit recognize the importance of importance of economic development in the territory of Nunavik and believe that the mining industry can be an important tool for economic and social development, provided that activities are conducted in a socially and environmentally responsible manner and fully respect the treaty rights of Nunavik Inuit. On November 19, 2014, McKivick Corporation released a policy on mining in Nunavik. The Nunavik Inuit mining policy will support mining development in Nunavik that is responsible and equitable, meaning that Nunavik Inuit must derive significant benefits during the exploration, development, operation, and restoration phase of mining activities, and that these activities take into account the Nunavik Inuit way of life are carried out in accordance with Nunavik Inuit rights and the James Bay Northern Quebec Agreement, as well as with all applicable federal and provincial legislation respecting environment and social protection. To conclude, I want to quote an elder from my community who said at the BAP and KEAC public hearing in September 2014, and so, even if it is in the water or inland, as communities, we need to know what is happening. Truthfully, transparently, rather, it is in Kangiqsualujjuaq or in Kujuaq or elsewhere in the region, and to be very involved in the early stage of development. We want total transparency, especially if there is going to be interest in the future. Nakokmi, thank you.
Please welcome Kirstin from Saskatchewan.
Awesome. So thanks so much for having me here. My name is Kirstin Scansen. I come from northern Saskatchewan. I'm from the Lac La Ronge First Nation, and I'm from a small community called La Ronge. I come to you today as an individual from a nation that has definitely benefited from uranium mining. We've essentially been, you know, perpetrators who are Indigenous in the uranium mining industry in northern Saskatchewan. I come here speaking to you in solidarity with our neighbors to the north, the Denisouthlene. We have benefited from the contamination of Denisouthlene territory. I come to you today as an individual from a nation that has benefited from nuclear weaponry, benefited from depleted uranium weaponry, you know, the sale of yellow cake to Ontario. So I was asked by a friend of mine, you know, how does it feel to be from a community that's like that? I mean, we have as much as 14% of the 10,000 of us who are indirectly or directly employed in the uranium mining industry. And I was thinking about that. How would I answer that? You know, I really thought about it, and I said to her, I don't feel. I stopped feeling a long time ago, because if I felt, I would really grasp the, you know, cognitive dissonance of it all. And so I really enjoyed to hear from everybody that's, you know, shared about struggles, you know, regarding uranium mining and the nuclear industry where they are from. And I want to give a little bit of a description about my community, the effects that uranium mining has had, and how it has changed us. So we have been dealing with uranium mining for about 50 years now. When we first were faced with the, you know, prospect of having this on our territory, we were, you know, not really sure what we were expecting. We didn't know what was going to happen, but we were, you know, we educated ourselves, and after a while, we were staunchly opposed to uranium mining. And we expressed that numerous times over and over again. We are a people that have been dealing with colonialism for 300 years. It began, you know, in the late 1700s. We've experienced residential school. We've experienced the dispossession of our governance structures, the dispossession of our language, the dispossession of our land, you know, the relegation to reserves on our traditional territory. And we've experienced a great deal of, you know, mental, emotional, spiritual, physical, and sexual violence. We are a people that are, you know, scarred with intergenerational trauma from all of this. And we are a people who have been engaging with the nuclear industry now for 50 years. And I think that this, you know, colonial history really has created the ideal situation for the uranium mining industry. In residential school, our children were taught to obey, and we faced a lot of violence in that. And I'm, to be honest, I think that that has really played a role in where we have sought justice in the past. We are consistently directed toward, you know, seeking justice in terms of uranium mining in state-centered institutions. And I'm here to talk to you today about a particular state-centered institution, which is the Canadian Nuclear Safety Commission. The Canadian Nuclear Safety Commission is the federal regulatory body for the uranium mining industry, the nuclear industry in Canada. We deal with them, you know, frequently when they are relicensing mines. It takes the form of like hearings, meetings, that kind of thing. I'm just gonna catch up with my PowerPoint. And as you know, the government and as the corporations and as the federal regulators, the CNSC really relies on the Indian Act structure and the colonial structure of Canada today. In the late 1800s, with the birth of Canada and with the creation of the Indian Act, there were certain specific structures imposed on our communities, and these were the band council systems. Many of you are probably familiar. That's the chief and council that we come to know today. These are not traditional. We didn't traditionally have one chief. We didn't traditionally have one Ogumagan who was, you know, dictator of all things in the community. We had a really organic form of leadership whereby individuals, according to their skill sets that they could offer, would give back to their community. We had, you know, roving forms of leadership, and we had a number of different leaders who specialized in, you know, war, they specialized in peace, they specialized in traditional knowledge, they specialized in, you know, home and the family, that kind of thing. When, you know, this word Ogumagan that's a new word. It was created by the elders back in the 1800s, and it's actually, it kind of shows their very detailed political analysis and also a certain sense of humor, because Ogumagan is a word from the root word ogumau, which is a boss or a leader, and the suffix igan is actually used to denote that something is false. So for example, a muskwa, that's a bear, and a muskwagan is a teddy bear. And so when they use this term, ogumagan, it was meant to really recognize the fact that there was a certain impotence that these chiefs had, especially as it related to the long-term well-being of the nation. And I think that the Canadian Nuclear Safety Commission really recognizes that. You know, the way that they operate and the way that Canadian law operates really relies on the fact that they have imposed a specific system that disempowers people from making, you know, real decisions, especially in regards to the land.
Yeah.
Thanks, Dale. Yeah, and it's true, and it has definitely played a role. In addition to a certain amount of financial coercion on the part of the federal government, on a certain amount of financial coercion that is brought forth by the uranium mining corporations. And so the regulatory process, you know, takes place as meetings, takes place as hearings, and is meant to be consultation, a term that we're probably all, you know, really familiar with. Ideally, consultation is a process, you know, whereby there's a dialogical connection and whereby there's a great deal of respect between two parties. And I think that this idea of what consultation really should be is something that the federal government really hopes that people believe. And as consultation has played out in terms of, you know, my community and our experience with the uranium mining, as well as, you know, with the Cree Nation of Mistissini, as I understand it, is that, you know, the Indigenous veto or the opportunity for Indigenous people to, you know, be opposed to and have their viewpoints respected in this context has never happened. As I mentioned, we've been fighting this for 60 years, and all throughout we have consistently brought forth our opposition. There are four official stages to consultation in the Canadian legal framework. That is pre-consultation, analysis and planning, Crown consultation process, accommodation, implementation and follow-up. I'm going to translate these really briefly. The pre-consultation, analysis and planning process is whereby the government collects all the documents necessary. What this looked like in my community was, you know, when I went looking for information on a particular project, I found a binder in a back room that was supposed, it was this thick, and we all had a month to respond. So we had one binder for 10,000 people, and so that's kind of that first process. The Crown consultation process is, you know, a situation where parties are brought together and the concerns of the Indigenous people are heard. Accommodation is a special process in the consultation process whereby if there's enough political will and whereby if there's enough, you know, chance of resistance, the government will kind of try to accommodate some measures in order to quell this resistance. They have been largely ineffective, have taken the form of, for example, the fact that some trappers are allowed to keep their mines next to, or sorry, to keep their trap lines next to the mines. And then, of course, implementation and follow-up is where we get the letter saying it's going to go through. So this is my translation of the legal framework of consultation. Now, consultation as a process is paramount to the Canadian state, and it reigns over all other, you know, international rights, all over, all other legal rights. And we have seen this frequently at the level of the United Nations and any kind of international declaration that has come out. In each of these situations, the Canadian state has said, well, we have an issue with the term free, prior, and informed consent. And they said that we would prefer to use the consultation as a legal framework in that instance. And so we have this situation whereby there really isn't any decision-making authority at the part of Indigenous nations. And so I just kind of wanted to reflect on that really briefly. There are a number of treaties that actually are, you know, the legal framework that we should be relying on. These are a blueprint for a just framework. As you can see, we have Treaty 6, in the central Saskatchewan. I am a Treaty 6 woman. We have Treaty 10 in the north. My family, a lot of us are from, you know, the Treaty 10 territory in the north. And then we have Treaty 8. All of these treaties are agreements that imbue both parties with certain responsibilities, the first of which is, you know, respect for each other. The second of which is definitely, you know, respect for the land. One elder that I know was mentioning that his family had told him, you know, we didn't have, nobody has the capacity to, or the right to destroy territory, so we never gave the right to anyone else to destroy territory. And that has played, you know, a big role in what that traditional law looks like on our territory. You know, as I mentioned, we have been resisting for 60 years. And in 1985, in one of the first instances of direct action, we had the Wollaston Lake blockade, which is a four-day blockade. And there were 150 people involved. And that lasted for 4 days and only ended because the uranium mining corporations actually agreed to meet with the chiefs from the north. There are a number of lessons that we learned from that, and there are a number of transformations we've seen in northern Saskatchewan as a result of that. What we see now is an increase in the manipulation of messaging. We see an increase in the lack of real scientific information, you know, coming into our conversations in the north. There are no or very few critical conversations or room for critical conversations in the north. I know you know, some friends and I started to organize like a workshop for when we were facing nuclear waste in the north. And I couldn't find a building that would host us, and I ended up having to pay a lot of money, pay someone to give us a room. And so that's just kind of the culture of I think it is, frankly, fear, but also the culture of being economically involved in this these projects in northern Saskatchewan. Another thing that happened was that the corporations recognized that there was a need to employ Indigenous people in northern Saskatchewan in order to, again, minimize resistance. And so, you know, when people say, it's a really good thing that there are a lot of Indigenous people in the mines, you know, 1,400 of my people working directly or indirectly, it really is a very strategic strategy on the part of the corporations to minimize resistance. I have a minute left here. And I wanted to speak briefly to the Cree Nation of Mistissini. I wanted to say just outright that we are very, very grateful for the stance that you have put up. You set an incredible moral precedent. And I can't speak for, you know, the political part of my nation, but I can speak for the large number of grassroots people. We stand in support of you, and we're very, very grateful for you. You have our full and complete support, and thank you very much.
We will now welcome Lorraine Rekmans from Ontario.
Thank you. Ani Peshe Dishnikos, Ganabajing and Jabayan. I just introduced myself in the Anishinaabe language, and I shared with you, and I have invoked my spirit name as I have been directed to do when I am addressing people. So Miigwech. Thank you to the organizers. Thank you to everyone who is here. I'm very honored and very pleased to be here on the traditional territory of the Huron-Wendat people to discuss this issue. I'm from Elliot Lake. I was born and raised there, and my father worked in the uranium mines. My older brother worked in the uranium mines there. And I cut my teeth on the nuclear issue as a young journalist working there in Elliot Lake, reporting primarily on the nuclear accidents and the mine spills and uncontrolled releases. So as a young woman, I had the experience of being traumatized, abused, harassed, nearly choked and punched, called a whore, because I was speaking out against the nuclear industry in a town where 3,500 men worked underground for two large corporations. So I'm very honored to be standing here today as a survivor of the intergenerational trauma that Kirstin talked about, and as a survivor of the corporate colonialism, trauma, abuse, racism, violence, exclusion, sickness, and death that was brought to my community by the nuclear industry. So I wanted to talk about the social and ecological costs of uranium. I came here, I had a cheeky slide about the top 10 reasons not to mine uranium. But I don't want to be glib about what our experience was at Elliott Lake with 160 million tons of radioactive waste that destroyed 10 lakes. You know, the waste was dumped into the existing lakes untreated, and the tailings were left uncovered for decades, blowing over the community, contaminating the Serpent River watershed. It's an area that is covered by the Robinson-Huron Treaty of 1850. It is an area that is covered by an agreement of coexistence and sharing. So I wanted also to talk about future costs that have not yet been calculated. Costs of violating an international agreement between two nations who agreed to coexist, the cost of the land that has been taken away from future generations, the cost of the water that has been taken away from future generations. Countries like Canada will realize the costs associated with the violation of these international legal agreements. So when we talk about the economics of uranium mining and the associated costs with the nuclear industry, we have not even reached the tip of the iceberg when we consider that when the Indigenous nations are organized enough to launch the campaign for compensation for the violation of these treaties, it will be astronomical. The other point I would like to make about protection of the environment, resistance, is that people are still jailed in this country. We had Bob Lovelace spend 6 months in jail for protesting a uranium exploration development at Charbet Lake. It's hard. It's very difficult to be here today, and I think the first thing I heard this morning when I woke up was about the young Indigenous woman who was taken off of life support after suffering a brutal beating. And I have a long history of watching trauma and dealing with this kind of abuse against women and against Mother Earth. And I do draw a correlation between those two things, between the mental unwellness, the mental instability, and Helen Caldicott called it madness. You know, and I like to be a little kinder and say it's mental unwellness that draws people to destroy their environment, to destroy Mother Earth, and to destroy women. So I wanted to frame that for you so you know a little bit about who I am, where I come from, what I believe in, and what we've suffered through, and that I would like this conference to recognize the strength, the courage, the tenacity, the challenges that every Indigenous woman, every woman who deals with this issue has to suffer through, and I would like you to acknowledge them. So now I can get into my glib little slideshow. It's green. So I just sort of borrowing from David Letterman, I wanted to talk about decommissioning because this is the situation that I live in, and this is by no means over. This is a federal panel came in the 1990s and decided that they were going to hold an environmental assessment on the decommissioning of the mines at Elliott Lake, and what they came up with was perpetual care and said they were going to keep a water cover on top of these tailings and they were going to monitor the runoff. So with the first slide, decommissioning is perpetual. So the environmental assessment panel realized that there's never going to be a walk-away solution. There's never going to be zero risk. There were no measures taken to put liners in these. They called them existing basins. They were lakes, completely filled. And the environmental assessment didn't even account for the cavalier way that the mining industry operated before it actually started to contain the waste in the early 1950s. Untreated effluent, etc. They said, we have no crystal ball. We can't foresee the environmental relationship that will involve these tailings in the millennia to come. This is an environmental panel. These are scientists saying, we don't have a crystal ball. 160 million tons of finely divided waste rock, significant quantities of radioactive isotope, heavy metals, and acid-generating sulfides. So the management regime is basically to keep the water cover on, stop the tailings from oxidizing, and treat the acidic effluent that is released with lime. And this is what, I mean, is being released into the Serpent River watershed. Reason number two, monitoring decommissioned sites is expensive. So just at Elliott Lake alone, it was actually $55 million that was spent in the initial decommissioning. And someone mentioned it earlier at the conference, I think it was Paul Robinson, that a lot of this work had been done before the environmental assessment even started. So the environmental assessment was just sort of a puppet show. This $750,000 is what is spent by Denison Environmental Services. So the mining company who created the waste created an environmental monitoring company that it set up to monitor. So this is a picture of what the area looked like, and they are working on the decommissioning in this slide. And again, you know, the ratepayer is left holding the bag because if the insurance doesn't cover the costs of the damage due to a breach in the dam, then the province of Ontario and the government of Canada have an assurance in any event. So in the climate that we live in today, we have no real indication of how these tailings are going to react to climate change. But there's also the important point that these things are located on two very significant faults that are north of Lake Huron, so the Murray Fault, Quirk, Flack Lake Fault line. So here's some more work. There are 86 dams, and the panel, the environmental assessment panel, said it's not a matter of if the dams will fail, it's a matter of when. So again, the perpetual cost, the ever vigilance that's required to keep those dams. And we did have an incident where a beaver came in and decided to build his own dam and caused the flooding of the tailings, and they actually spilled out into an area where the local community was using as a ski hill. Number three, it's very water consumptive, and for the scientists who are in this room, I always wish that we could get a number, you know, in terms of the total water consumption of this industry worldwide, if we could measure every drop. So we've lost a watershed. So we have a watershed minus 10 lakes, minus the perpetual water cover, plus the migration of contaminants into other water systems, which is Lake Huron, minus the water consumed in reactors, equals X. It's the big unknown. So, standards are inconsistent across jurisdictions, and we heard a bit about this today. The WHO, Canadian Nuclear Safety Commission, Health Canada. Who I didn't add was actually Aboriginal Affairs. So in my community, we were governed by the Indian Act, so we were subject to different standards than the people who were in a municipality. Even though we were taking our water from the same system, the non-Aboriginal municipality got a water treatment plant, but the First Nation didn't get a water treatment plant because we were somehow able to consume more radioactive material than non-Aboriginal people. So here's an example between radiation and water, between the Canadian Nuclear Safety Commission and Health Canada. This is a little bit of my confusion about what's a nanogray per second and how many millisieverts is that a year. So some of the challenges that we have as Indigenous people or lay people reading these reports, I get information about radiation levels, and this is from 2014. They're at 200 nanograys per hour, and they peak at 2,700 nanograys per hour due to the uranium mine tailings. So that's a piece of information that I really can't interpret as a layperson, but it doesn't sound good to me. uranium mining impacts health, so again, lung cancer, silicosis, a lot of stuff that the Workplace Safety Insurance Board doesn't recognize, stuff that's been identified in the Beer 7 report. Standards are very backwards in Ontario. These are my boys. This is a miner's memorial at Elliot Lake. These are all the men who have died as a result of mine-related illness. That's my oldest son, Christopher, on the left-hand slide. And my youngest son, Joshua, and his daughter, my granddaughter, Faith, and they're visiting my father's memorial. He died, the thing is, he died a poor miner, and he was cremated, and we never had a headstone for him. And then years later, the steelworkers decided to put up this miner's memorial, and I said, Dad, you've got the biggest monument in the whole town. So I hope it stays forever. I hope it's never forgotten. Okay, again, speaking to health, and these doctors are threatening to leave, and I applaud the doctors for taking that stand. Number six, it contributes to global insecurity. We've talked about weapons and plutonium coming from reactors. Most of the uranium is exported, so it's not even Canadian consumption. It devastates ecosystems and watersheds. It removes land from use forever. So there's Serpent River First Nation in the North Channel, and that's the Serpent River watershed, and you can see all the mines and the tailings there. Number nine. So someone did mention this during the week, and I was really happy to hear it, is that the reliance on this old archaic technology is robbing us of a vision for a better tomorrow, that we're so consumed. If every one of us in this room did not have to fight nuclear energy, what else would we be doing? Art, music? Hugging the planet? Okay, and my last slide. Okay, again, so what's new? Nothing, really. Same old thing, same old waste management technologies. Number 10, it's a violation of Aboriginal and treaty rights. This is a report that came out about Indigenous people being impacted by development, of course, that never generates wealth for our communities. And these are Supreme Court decisions in Canada. So you can see how the case law is evolving, and I talked earlier about the future cost that has not yet been realized. And here we go. Two really smart guys, Frank Zappa and Albert Einstein, together. So Frank Zappa says, you can't be a real country unless you have a beer and an airline. It helps if you have some kind of football team or some nuclear weapons. But at the very least, you need a beer. And again, of course, Einstein insanity is doing the same thing over and over again, but expecting different results. Thank you very much for your attention.
Et maintenant, le mot de la fin avec Ghislain Picard, le chef de l'Assemblée des Premières Nations.
Assembly of First Nations, the Quebec and Labrador. Ghislain Picard.
Tu peux regarder non, Marc. Tu te mets à non. Bien, puis tibi moi, je dis. Vad måste ha gått den I Hegabujat nespes med sig gådan. Assi. Men jag gåskat sig ut man när det med skott tigarna hennor det gått sjuden. Den det vill upp till mina gånått på några här alltså till I mått mag I mstja vet att tjegoan. So I'm the one who will be speaking French.
In fact, I started in the Innu language. That was Innu, my introduction. I think it's very important to recognize who we are as a people. It's a lot about our identity, and identity is about our language. Our lands. I wanted to start by thanking the Huron-Wendat Nation, welcoming us this week on their land, and it shows also a way of doing things which dates back thousands of years, our openness, hospitality, and welcoming spirit. I want to welcome also.
Welcome our sisters and brothers from other Indigenous nations across the globe who are taking part in these proceedings this week. Very, very important for the future of our nations.
I also
certainly. Recognize as well Grand Chief Matthew Kunkum of the Cree Nation, who is also part of the discussion this morning. Je suis Inu.
I am Inu from the Inu Nation. For those who know about geography, Inu land is in the eastern part of Quebec. It's all the peninsula, Quebec, Labrador. It's about 12 or 11 Inu communities on two jurisdictions, Quebec province and Labrador, Newfoundland province. Our land is Nitatsinan, our land. Inu means a human being. In most native languages in Canada, is the same, and probably globally it's the same. I would like first to specify that while I'm here with you in this room, there is a delegation of my nation, three chiefs of my nation, and a few representatives. They are currently in Europe to try and put some pressure on Rio Tinto Multinational Corporation. You know, I've heard about that. And so that it repairs the damages caused in Nitasiman. In this case, the precious ore developed, it was about iron ore that was developed or mined. A leader said that his territory today is the largest golf course in the world, with holes left by mining corporation after mining between 1950s and 1980s. It is an example, a very good example. And there are many others too, but an example of resilience from our people and our intent to change perceptions and to challenge the colonialist ideology that is still persists today in Canadian policies dealing with our people. Many things have changed since the last century, at a time when discovering people and lands was something that was done very often and praised. In 1923, a Mohawk leader, Discahe chief, asked the League of Nations at the time to recognize our people, to recognize their nation, and to recognize their governance. Today, a century later, who would have believed that we have a universal declaration on the rights of Indigenous people? The chief Discahe would be proud. Today, even the doctrine of discovery is over, obsolete now. Even if some will continue to deny it. I am standing here today as the chief of the First Nation of Quebec and Labrador, 10 nations, 43 communities, and we confirm our support to the joint declaration against the mining of uranium. Our collective position as a nation dates back in 2003. We would express our position on nuclear industry and also on the nuclear waste management, and also a reflection about Gentilly plant in Quebec. Always, we were very determined. Mining of uranium is not an option. Uranium is not an acceptable risk. Social impacts and environmental impacts are way beyond the economic benefits. We know very well that for every ton of uranium, there are thousands of tons of mining waste that, as we know, are still toxic and radioactive for thousands of years. Exploration of uranium is a threat, a direct threat to the lifestyle of our people. But the strongest or most powerful argument is the one that is stated on the United Declaration on Indigenous People in the 46th principle. It says in that declaration that for any development on traditional lands, the first principle that applies, first and foremost, is the free consent and informed consent, free prior informed consent. This principle is added to the specific situation of our people. Many of us, we are We have claims on our territories. Many of us, we are signatory of treaties that guarantee rights, that we are the only ones to have. Another special situation is in the Canadian Constitution. They recognize our people, and they recognize our ancestral rights. However, we also have to understand that our people are not against development. We support projects that are responsible, that take into account our rights, and above all, that guarantee the necessary balance between protection of the Nehithaw or ancestral lands and an economy that will allow us to get rid of the state independence. This is what all our nations wish. In the contents of the uranium industry, our chiefs, our nations, in respect of their autonomy, together they agreed to reject mining of uranium. Moreover, because of the radioactive potential of rare ore, our leaders committed a few weeks ago to include in their position the development of rare earth, the mining of rare earth. Representing the recent positions taken by our leaders.
As governments, obviously, we find ourselves in a position where we need to find ways to engage governments. So it is our wish as First Nations in this province of Canada to find the most honorable conditions to engage the Quebec government. Many of you may know that we're only 1 year into a new government in Quebec, the government of Premier Couillard, and we're trying to set what we feel are the right conditions to engage. We have taken part in all processes in place that have to do with environmental assessments throughout the years. We have made numerous representations before the National Assembly on numerous issues affecting our peoples. And we find ourselves, sadly, in a position where we continually have to re-educate politicians in this province, and why not throughout Canada? It's never a comfortable position, and it's always a frustrating one. But we are committed as nations to do what is necessary so that people will understand where we stand and why we take the positions that we take. We're confident that the governor, Mr. Couillard, will agree to the conditions that we set in order to engage. That's the process that we are finding ourselves in as I speak to you today. And in closing, I will just refer to a thought of one Inu elder. This is a number of years ago. As I was traveling with him, he looked around and said, looking at the land, he said, to me, the Creator must have had a lot of faith in us as peoples, as Indigenous peoples, to trust us to take care of Mother Earth. And we've managed to do it for thousands of years. Now look at what they have done in just a few centuries. Merci beaucoup. Monsieur Commandant, thank you.
On a le temps pour deux questions. We have time for two questions, if any of you do have questions. Only one. Yes, you have to go to the microphone, please. Yes, a quick one.
Et merci et
thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you to the Wendat Nation for your warm welcome. Thank you to the Cree Nation for everything they did.
So, because we have some of the men leaders and we have some really strong women leadership here, I'd like to ask this question to all the presenters, how you feel about what I've learned to be a traditional Ganyagehaga Mohawk process of the Women's Council being seized with the issues of the day before the Men's Council. In other words, whenever there's a serious issue regarding whatever, it could be scientific, it could be economic, it could be obviously family, it could be social, it could be international politics. If the Women's Council is seized with the issue of the day before the Men's Council, in other words, the Women's Circle is seized with the issues of the day and allowed uninterrupted without any interference from the men, and then will present back their understanding of the day to the men or the men's representative. If you could perhaps make some comments on this as obviously as regional leaders, as engaged women, people of of some stature. I'd appreciate your feedback on that, please.
So women should know first.
Of course.
Yeah, I think I did talk in the workshop this week earlier about, a reconstitution of nations and traditional governance structures. So the reality that we live under today, I mean, we do live under the Indian Act, and we have colonial institutions that are entrenched. And outside of that, we have non-legal, but more traditional cultural things go on in a community, and a lot of chiefs will tell you if the women ain't happy, But it's very unofficial. And the message that's being sent out to corporations that are doing consultation, and like one of the things that troubles me about Nuclear Waste Management Organization, it's a corporation. And as Indigenous people, we want nation-to-nation relationships. And there has to be investment, support, and dedication to rebuilding traditional governance systems so that we don't end up with the discord in our community. We don't even have a true democracy in Canada with a first-past-the-post system. This democratic system does not work for the colonizers, and it's not working for Indigenous communities. So the chief and council system is very divisive in our communities, and we have to reimagine power structures and how to share power in our communities.
One last, please.
Thank you very much for your presentations. One of the irreplaceable losses resulting from uranium mining is the cultural heritage of the families that are ended or the family groups that are ended. And Dennis Sulane had a book that it had put together that's rare and out of print, and Lorraine has some of that memory in a book that's out of print. So I'm wondering, what are some of the ways that you think will be effective to keep those memories that are so rare and irreplaceable, that are the permanent losses, not the environmental, the community? Thank you.
Thank you for your question. Northern Saskatchewan is pretty far away from a city, and we actually are really still strongly involved in our land-based culture. But I'm from a community that's not, directly where the mines are, and so I can't speak on behalf of the Denisovan and what their experience has been. But we are lucky enough to continue that tradition. I know what you mean about materials and informations that are out of print and difficult to find. I did my research and I found, finding books and finding that kind of stuff was really difficult. And I'm, certain that there are more and more conversations going on between elders and young people. The young people in northern Saskatchewan are really getting involved, and so there are, you know, more and more, you know, personal conversations going on. But as I mentioned, language is still really strong in northern Saskatchewan. I don't speak Cree. Most of my friends speak Cree, and many Dene people speak Dene Suthene. But also, you know, there are people who are trapping. There are people who are hunting and fishing, and that knowledge is still passed on. So. You know, if the spirit of resistance that people previously had would be passed on too, that would be awesome. Thanks.
So one could come in from Lorraine, and then you want to talk too.
So we've existed at Serpent River as Anishinaabe people since time immemorial. We were there before the mines. We were there before the tailings were created. It's our homeland. I mean, that's the name of the book. This is my homeland. And it is a legacy. So our role as Indigenous people is stewardship. Our role is to be a steward of Mother Earth. We've been excluded. We were excluded from the environmental assessment. The corporation took over the environmental monitoring system. We don't trust them. We know they're kind of transient. Eventually, they're going to leave. And the challenge is to invest in the technology and the capacity development to support our community to live in perpetuity and care for that mess that was created. That's our responsibility. We have an inalienable right to exist in our lands as Indigenous people, but we also have an inalienable responsibility to fulfill our duty. And if it means cleaning up the mess that some foreign corporation made, we have no choice. But what we need is the resources, we need the capacity, we need the training, and we need the money to do it.
This is just in response to the first question that was asked. With regards to the uranium project, the leadership back then as a council decided to involve the Native Women's Association, the Elders Council, and the Youth Council in getting information from the proponent of the project before any decision was made by the council. So we did involve the community of Mistissini, the local Native Women's Association, and we took their considerations and feedback during that time.
It would be unjust. You were the first to stand up, so the question.
Just a comment to the man from Mistissini. It's crystal clear where you stand on uranium. But you said regarding the longevity of the materials, you said some people say that it will last for a long time. And I just want to point out, it's not a matter of opinion. It's a law of matter, the same law that discovered the fissioning of the atom, discovered the long half-lives. So you don't need to put it in the court of opinion. It's the law of nature that these wastes will be there essentially forever. That's what I wanted to say.
Thank you. A few more comments, I guess, from Hugo Lapointe pour que le Québec ait meilleure mine.
I have a quick question.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Okay.
Leona? Quick?
Yeah. Very quick.
Okay.
In my language, we have a word for uranium, which is tletzo, and we do not have words for money, capitalism, exploitation, these kinds of things. Do you all have a word for uranium in your language? And if so, we can talk more at lunch about it. Does anyone have a word for uranium? Because we were taught about it before colonialism.
Okay.
Thank you.
Which means? Bad rock? Bad rock. Do you want to say it?
Yeah, we do have a word for uranium. It's keskituipago. And we do have a word for money. It's suniao. And we do have a word for white person. It's Munyao. And I always wondered why they rhyme, why they're so close, but I don't have enough information to go into detail.